Well, please remain standing for the reading of God's word. Please turn, if you will, to John chapter 6. John chapter 6, picking up the narrative at verse 41 and reading through to verse 59. It's the second treatment of what's known as the bread of life discourse. John chapter 6, verse 41, page 892 in your pew Bible. Our Lord has just revealed himself to be the bread of life, and we pick up the narrative in verse 41, reading thus. So the Jews grumbled about him because he said, I am the bread of life that came down from heaven. They said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Then the Jews disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on that last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum. Amen. Let's pray. Feed us now, Lord God, on this bread that leads to eternal life. Reveal to us Christ. Reveal to us your sovereign grace in salvation. And reveal unto us, Lord God, the necessary response. Speak to us, Lord God. Give us ears to hear, that we might rejoice in our blessed Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. One of the great problems of the Jews who lived at the time of Christ was thinking that saving faith, or a right relationship with God, was constituted by their covenant lineage. That is to say, if they conducted themselves externally in what appeared to be a right relationship with God, their covenant lineage, their spiritual ancestors, would in a way count for something before God. They thought that their shared experiences, such as the Exodus, which is behind this narrative, the Exodus and the manna and the quail from heaven, counted for something. In other words, they trusted in things which God had not given them to trust in. And so our Lord Jesus, as he came to this earth and came to his own people, his great desire is to see them saved. He instructs them, especially in this passage, in the nature of saving faith. What is saving faith? It is focused purely on Jesus Christ. Saving faith in this passage, then, is likened to us feeding on Christ. Unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood. Saving faith is likened to feeding on Christ. That is the level of intimacy and interconnectedness between Christ and his brethren when we have saving faith in him. Our relationship to Christ is likened to eating and drinking of him. To believe in Christ, then, brethren, is not to focus on what we've known in the past, who we've known in the past, what we do in the church presently. It is focused on one thing and one thing only, Jesus Christ as Savior. To believe in Christ is to have Christ, is to feed upon Christ. And in this section, verse 41 to 59, I think we see two matters laid before us. As our Lord is speaking to the Jews, in verses 41 to 47, and this will be a slight change to the outline that was sent out, verses 41 to 47, our Lord talks about the reasons why people are not saved. The reasons why people are not saved, and there's more than one reason. But then, having identified why people aren't saved, he then reveals to them how they can be saved, how they can have that life of which he speaks. That is to say, in verse 48 to 59, he reveals that feeding on Christ, faith in him alone, is what truly saves a man or a woman. Look first of all at verse 41 following. Bear in mind where we are in John's Gospel. We've seen in chapter 6 a series of missteps by the Galilean Jews. Jesus is back in the Galilee region. It's the time of the Passover, and this passage is reminiscent of the Exodus narrative, as we've seen before. Christ feeds his people. He leads his people by green pastures, much in the way as God led the children of Israel out of Egypt, sustained them with the manna, and led them into the promised land. And the people are happy to receive Christ's provision until he does what? Until he starts teaching. They're happy to have their bellies filled until Jesus says to them, actually, don't look at your bellies being filled. Don't even look at your history. Look at me. I am the bread of life, John 6:35. He tells them in verse 27, don't labor for the food which perishes. And he's talking about manna and so on. It's at that point that the Jews of Galilee reveal themselves to be people who are looking for the wrong Messiah. They're looking for the wrong Messiah. So when the real Messiah comes, they miss him almost entirely. And this reality of their response, they missed him, is accentuated by our Lord Jesus Christ saying, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And so in verse 41, we come across a very, very familiar response of the people. So the Jews grumbled about him. Does that remind you of anything? Just as I've said, the Exodus in its imagery is at the back of this narrative. What do we see in the Exodus? No sooner had God brought them out of Egypt and was leading them through the promised land, sustaining them by manna in the morning and quail at night. What do? Exodus 16, verse 2. And the whole congregation of the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. Exodus 17, verse 1. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages and encamped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people quarreled with Moses. Fast forward, Numbers chapter 11, verse 1. And the people complained in the hearing of the Lord about their misfortunes. And when the Lord heard it, his anger was kindled, and the fire of the Lord burned among them and consumed some outlying parts of the camp. Why was the anger of the Lord kindled against his people of old? Because they despised the means that he had given to deliver them from Egypt and their hunger and sustain them. They despised the manna. They despised the water. Oh, that we could go back to Egypt and eat our fill as we did then. They despised the Lord's way. And now what do we have here in John 6? History sadly repeating itself. Why were the Jews grumbling about Christ? Fundamentally, because they despised God's way of salvation and deliverance. Jesus was that way, and they despised him. Brethren, do we not get an inkling into the blindness of natural man, and indeed your very own blindness as what you are as a natural man? See our propensity here, brethren, to grumble in the face of God, even when he gives us good things, even when he gives us his own Son and salvation. We have a natural propensity to dissatisfaction. And the Jews here grumble because they think they know who Jesus is. And yet in grumbling, they show how little they know who he is. Verse 42, they said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Notice their problem. Who is Jesus? They know who he is, they think, the son of Mary and Joseph. How can he now say he has come down from heaven? So what does our Lord do? Notice he does not get into a debate about his identity. He doesn't answer their question. Frequently you'll see in John's Gospel our Lord answering the question that should have been asked, or answering the question which underlies what has been said by the Jews. They're doubting his identity and thus questioning how he can be the bread of life. What does our Lord do? He goes to the heart of the matter. In a sense, in this section, our Lord is more interested in the why than in the what. That is to say, he is more interested in finding out why, or teaching them why they won't believe, than engaging in a debate about the smaller things. And brethren, that might be a lesson for us, each one of us also, to examine not necessarily what we or others think or say, but rather to ask, why are we thinking in this way? What is it within my heart that causes me to speak in such a way? Or what is it within someone else that causes them to react to me in such a way? That's following our Lord's example in this case. You see, our Lord deals with the heart of man. The heart of man. Now remember, where are we in the gospel? We're in the festival cycle. We've had the Cana cycle. Now we're in the festival cycle. It's Passover. Chapter 6, verse 4, the Passover of the Jews was at hand. And Passover was to remind the people how God had delivered them. Not how they had delivered themselves, but how God had delivered them. It was to remind them that God's ways are not our ways, and our ways are not his ways. And the Jews' grumbling revealed a presenting problem. They thought they could debate who Jesus was. They thought they could resist his claims, saying they knew who he was. That's just a presenting problem. Our Lord here is revealing the root problem. The root problem is this: the Jews' unwillingness to come to God on his terms. Notice that. To come to God on his terms. No one has ever had a saving relationship with God on their own terms. It's a pretty humbling thought. If you want a saving relationship with God, if you really want to be part of that Exodus, not those who perished in the wilderness who wanted God on their terms, if you want saving faith in Christ, it is not on your terms. It is on God's terms. The Jews were unwilling to come to faith in Christ, or rather come to God on his terms. That is to say, they did not and were not willing to put their faith in the one that stood before them and taught them that he was the bread of life. And this false faith is manifested in verse 66 of our same chapter. After this, after what? After he had taught them, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. This is, brethren, then, an example of false, insincere, and spurious faith. We come to God on his terms. And so Christ speaks to them there in verse 43 about the ultimate realities of salvation. And the ultimate reality of salvation is this: no one comes to the Father, no one believes in the Son, unless, verse 44, the Father draws him. Unless the Father draws him. The Jews were not believers in Christ because they had not been drawn by the Father. And that word draw there in the Greek is translated in different ways in the New Testament. In one passage where the disciples are hauling in that huge catch of fish, that's precisely how it's translated. They dragged or they hauled that catch of fish into the boat. You see, this drawing of God, this hauling of God, this dragging of God is a most powerful and effectual, a forceful and irresistible drawing of God. He draws people unto himself. It is a drawing which involves transformation of the heart, so that there is a change in the human heart, so that the human being, as he's drawn to God, is not drawn against his will. It's against his former will, but he is given a new heart that he might willingly be drawn to God. It is a drawing which changes the heart, changes the mind. It realigns our affections and desires. It reveals unto us the depths of our sin and the height of grace and salvation. Jesus says to them, verse 44, you won't believe me unless the Father draws you. And you might think, well, it's not their fault then, is it? They can just wait and wait for God to draw them. But what does he say in verse 43? Stop grumbling. Stop grumbling. If verse 44 is about God's sovereignty, verse 43 very clearly tells us they have a responsibility. And it's not just to stop grumbling. It's to receive Christ. It's to come to the Father through Christ. It's to receive Jesus as the bread of life. There's no contradiction here, you see, brethren. There's no contradiction between the sovereignty of God in salvation, where he works in us and draws us, and the responsibility of man to come to faith in Christ. No contradiction whatsoever. God is no less sovereign in who he saves than he is in the manner and method of salvation. What is the method of salvation that Christ is showing here? He says, come to the Father. He says, come to the Father. It is written in the prophets, verse 45, and they will be taught by God, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. There's a responsibility, you see, of every person to come to the Son in faith, to receive the Son in faith. I once had a friend, he grew up in the church, young man aged 18 or 19 many years back. I was trying to witness to him because he had gone down the wrong paths. And he thought that he had done his bit before God. He had lived in the covenant, he had come to church, he had done things in the church. He said, I've done my bit, now I'm waiting for God to do his. Brethren, I have to tell you, no one gets to say to God, I'm waiting for you to do your bit. Each has a responsibility to come. And you see, brethren, God's sovereignty in salvation does not negate our responsibility. Rather, it establishes our responsibility to come. Because God is sovereign, he determines everything, not only the outcome, but by the means of the outcome. That is to say, everyone in this room here present has a duty and responsibility to come to Christ. And in coming, we understand what? That it is God who is drawing us. Friend, if you haven't committed yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ, if you have not come to Christ, you cannot hide behind the sovereignty of God, the fact that he must draw us. Because he draws us not against our wills, but with our wills and through our wills, which he himself renews by the power of his Spirit. You cannot hide behind God's sovereignty and saying, I'm waiting for God to do his bit. You must come. The one who waits for God will always be waiting for God. No, you must come. But perhaps, and I suspect this is true of many of us here today, we've come into God's house feeling weak in our faith, struggling in our faith, challenges, interpersonal relationships, marriages, employment situations, troubles at home, whatever it might be, we've come in here feeling weak and struggling with our faith. Brethren, I have to tell you, it's not so much the strength of your faith. In fact, it's not at all the strength of your faith that saves you, but rather the strength of your Savior and the strength of Almighty God who has already drawn you. Your weakness of faith is not something which will undo your relationship with God. Now, is weak faith a good thing? No. We want a strong faith. But do not doubt in those moments of trial and challenge. Do not doubt that your faith is about to let go of God, because Scripture says He will never let go of us. The Father it is who draws us unto Him. That doesn't change. He doesn't stop. His drawing does not grow weak or old. It is He who has united you to your Savior by faith, so that you, dear friend, have the bread of life. You have this life which is everlasting. He might have dragged you, He might have hauled you, you might have come screaming and kicking, but you came to Christ, and life is never going to be the same again. He's given you Christ. And that's precisely what our Lord focuses upon, is it not? In verse 48, He teaches us that if we feed upon Christ, it is that which saves us. Now remember, He's teaching them against the backdrop of them talking to Him about manna and about Moses and about their fathers. And He says to them in verse 48, and you can almost see our Lord speaking to them, almost putting His hands on His chest and saying to them, I am the bread of life. They've got lost and hung up on their history. Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. Jesus is going to tell them, your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and died. And they did not make it into the promised land. And so Jesus says, don't look at your history. Don't look at your covenant lineage. It doesn't matter from what tribe you came from. It doesn't matter who your great-grandfather was. Just look at me. I am the bread of life, says our Lord Jesus Christ. He's contrasting Himself with the manna which did not save. Verse 49, your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This, verse 50, this is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. He's just stating once more what He's already taught them. Verse 27, do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life. See, it's not the manna. Something more precious, more valuable, more worthy, more life-giving is in your midst. And He's saying, it's me. I am this bread that has come down from heaven. And then He says something which, pun intended, is entirely unpalatable to the Jews. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Before we exegete that, just consider what our Lord is saying to us in this verse. John 6:51 and the latter half of that verse. Here, our Lord is teaching us that He has already come face to face with the gruesome reality that His body will be broken and His blood will be shed for His people. Even though, brethren, this Jesus is the one that came down from heaven, filled with glory and honor and majesty, he became flesh, and cursed flesh at that. Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. And so, brethren, we see in this text both the necessity and the irony of the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. The irony is this, that in the flesh of man is no good and lies that very seed and principle of death, and yet it is through the flesh of the man that life will come to his people. And the necessity of the incarnation is seen in this way, that as by man came death, so also by a man must come life. Our Lord is saying to us, some time before he dies, I'm going to die. I'm going to shed my blood, and my body will be broken for the life of the world. Unmistakably, he is using sacrificial language. What's he speaking of here? He's speaking of bread. He's speaking of flesh. He's saying this, to be saved, to have true faith, is likened then to feeding on Christ. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh, and that sets the Jews alight. It says here they disputed. That's a rather tame description or translation. It actually means there's a serious conflict and a sharp argument and disagreement among them. The Jews then disputed among themselves, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Don Carson, who's wrote an excellent commentary on the Gospel of John, says this, any dullard could see that Jesus was not speaking literally. And yet here they are. Jesus is speaking of a savior. The Jews are thinking cannibal. Idiocy. The darkness of such unbelief. So what does he do? He repeats and intensifies. He doesn't dilute. Notice that. He'd got a harsh response. He doesn't step back and say, okay, well, let me explain it in more palatable ways. No, he repeats and intensifies what he says, and he repeats it multiple times. He starts in verse 53 with the words, truly, truly, solemnly, I declare to you, says the Son of God, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. And just in case they didn't get the message, he says the same thing in verse 54, this time with an emphasis on the resurrection and eternal life. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. And just in case they didn't get the message again, he says it again in verse 56. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him, focusing upon union with Christ. And he says the same in verse 57. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. And if they didn't get the message, for the sixth time, verse 58, our Lord says this, this is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread that fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Six times Jesus says, feed on me and you'll have life. Six times! Emphasizing slightly different benefits or aspects of it each time, but essentially saying the same thing. Eat my flesh, drink my blood, and in that there is life. In that there is life. And to emphasize his point, he says right in the middle of that section, verse 55, for my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Herein Jesus is saying, in me then is found life. And the Jews should have realized this. They should have understood what he was saying. He's talked to them about coming to Christ, believing in Christ, and he is speaking about the necessity of having faith, the object of faith, Christ himself, and the nature of faith, that is to feed, to participate, to abide in Christ. The Jews should have understood what he was saying. Why? Because the concept of eating and drinking and feeding upon the sacrifice was not alien to them. Indeed, it was part of their very existence. Part of their sacrificial system was this, the shedding of blood, the covering of blood. Sometimes that blood would be administered to the one bringing the sacrifice, put on his ear, his right thumb, and his right toe. No self-respecting Jew should have missed the fact that Jesus was talking about participating in the blood of the sacrifice. Moreover, again, each Jew should have known that the life was found in the blood. But again, in their sacrificial system, the Jews, it was not a strange idea for them to eat the sacrifice, the peace offering. The peace offering to reestablish peace between them and God. They would give some to the priest to be burned, and they would eat the rest. And their food and drink offerings were used to restore their relationship and communion with God. Brethren, they should have seen. They should have known. They should have understood that here stood before them was the most compelling fulfillment of their sacrificial system. The conclusion is this: Christ's flesh and blood, his life and his death, are sufficient. They are sufficient. Do you see what faith does for you, brethren? It unites you to the sufficient one. It unites you to the worthy one. He abides in you, and you abide in him. I am his, as the hymn says, and he is mine. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That if any man comes unto Christ and believes in him, it is the equivalent, spiritually speaking, of eating of the flesh and drinking of the blood of our Lord. That is to say, the efficacy and value and worthiness of Christ's life and death become yours. Therein, brethren, is strength. Therein is comfort for the broken soul who mourns over sin. If you're struggling with your sin, brethren, what are you going to do today? You're going to go to Christ. What you should be doing now, coming to Christ through the Word. You're going to go to him, cry out to your Father in heaven, and say, Father, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Heal me, cleanse me, Lord God, that I might enjoy a life relationship with you. How do you do it? You do it in word. You do it in prayer as you commune with God. Brethren, I say to you, you can scarcely be a Christian. You can scarcely be a Christian without reading God's word and praying to God. That's what Christ is speaking of here. It's not just that one-off act of original faith, as it were, believing in Christ. Just like Luther said that our life is to be a life of complete and replete of repentance, so too is feeding on Christ. And we come to our Lord in the sacrament also. And this text informs that sacrament. It's as if our Lord is saying to us when we come to his table, look, dear brother, the bread, my flesh. Look, dear sister, the wine, my blood. This is my body, which is for you. Brethren, this is the gospel. Saving faith does not look anywhere else other than Jesus Christ. Why would it? Nothing else can give us Christ. Nothing else can give us life. And so in a sense, we need to put our working tools down. Stop trying to work for God's good graces. Stop trying to make up what you think is lacking in the work of Christ. There is no lack. There's only strength. There's only value. There's only completeness. Saving faith looks not only to Christ for salvation, but daily for sustenance. Can you fight the good fight on your own, dear friends? No. What are you going to do? You're going to feed on Christ, who is your life. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we pray that you would, in your mercy, work in us that faith which looks unto our Savior at every challenge and every trial. Be merciful to us, Lord God, granting faith to those that do not possess it and strengthening the faith of those of us who are weak. For we are all weak, and yet we love you and desire to serve you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.